Warren spoke about a lot of stuff that I wanted to talk about, so my presentation is going to be shorter, maybe about 10 minutes, because she took the balance 10 from me, right there. So let me try and see if I can do this in 10 minutes. Now, NDTV hopefully is not alien to anyone in the room, especially if you live in India. NDTV has been the pioneer of private news broadcast. We all remember The World This Week with Pranoy Roy, and that's about NDTV. Basically, our credentials are that we produce or broadcast news, as some channels would actually create news. We're not in that business. We essentially report what we see on the ground. With three news channels, 24/7, which is English, NDTV India, and I'd say NDTV India, and not just India, it's Hindi, and NDTV Profit, which is the business news channel. And there's, of course, NDTV Good Times, which is our lifestyle channel. There's a small little company NDTV also runs, it's called NDTV Worldwide, which is really media consulting. So it helps other channels launch their business, hopefully not competing business. So how will I structure this interaction? Very simple, talk a little more about the context, the reality vis-a-vis India. Dr. Warren spoke a little more from a global sense, but India, the realities are slightly different, and just focus on that, and finally some suggestions on what we do in terms of strategies and solutions. So what is the context? I mean, when my wife saw this slide, she said, why are you putting a desert slide in your presentation? So I said, this isn't a desert. It's a place in Mauritius called the Chamarelle. Basically highlighting that even the earth has different colors. If you look at this picture carefully, the soil is of seven different colors, and that's why the name Chamarelle. So what are the dimensions of diversity? Diversity just isn't gender-based or any other objective that we'd like to prefix. Three real dimensions: there's organizational, external, and of course internal dimensions, and we have to consider all of this when we put together the context for diversity. It's not just inward or outward, and I think it's all around. And things like, for instance, sexual orientation, when you juxtapose that with management status, you can imagine the kind of diverse workforce that we're now looking at. And the amount of factors that have now increased in our diversification meter, so to speak. So what is our reality? Now, essentially, diversity is in our DNA. India, of course, 29 states and so many union territories, and 325 languages spoken, and of course, 18 official languages. In fact, if I ask anyone in the room to name all 18, how many can actually do it? All 18 languages in India? Any tribes at all? Hindi, Gujarati. All right. Marathi? Okay, maybe 10. Let's say you get to 18. Don't Google it. Just so gender issues in India. Now, of course, if you look at our print and media, of course, I'm a media person, so. We 20%. Can you just pay a little more attention to the statistic? News on cricket takes 20% more space than women's issues, and that's tell you actually cricket news takes precedence over everything else. But it's just to illustrate my example. The maternal mortality rates. This is all very doom and gloom, and I'll come to the positive aspects later. Now, if men and women were to be treated equally in India, we'd have 1,005 women for every 100 men. But look at what the gender ratio is at the moment, and that's very surprising. So when Dr. Warren says that Japan's GDP would rise 16% if women were to be paid equally, I think India, we have a problem that we don't have enough women. So the 16% would actually need to be more like 30% for us to be able to, that's the advantage that we've got, actually. And of course, we know that some women never do get born, and that is a problem that still confronts us. So we're stuck in a bit of a medieval time trap, and we're not realizing that it's going to bite us pretty soon. Look at the amount of work that women do and spend at home, for instance, and these are Indian realities, and the amount of time they get to sleep. Everybody keeps talking about getting 8 hours of sleep. Does anyone bother about how much time their wife, sister, mother has had to sleep? Do we actually bother? Now, there's of course the issue of discrimination, which has been for a very long time being swept under the carpet. It's only when the Vishakha case, the landmark Vishakha judgment, which my learned colleagues will talk a bit later, and I promised that I would make a small reference to this case, and she'll talk about what this landmark judgment was. But when women were asked, when they asked what was the Vishakha judgment, actually 85% never knew there was a judgment like that. So this also illustrates the fact that we don't cover these things enough. And even if we do, we're not able to sustain them. What are the factors that restrict, therefore, women's career choices? There's gender preferences, stereotypes and bias. Dr. Warren spoke about that in detail. And of course, there's an inherent lack of confidence. Can I actually go ahead and do it? NDTV is a great example of how things can happen by design, and I'll talk about that a little later. But the impact, because there are so many factors restricting women's choices, you'll see that senior management in India the contribution of women in senior management is far lower than the global standard is. There's a survey, it's a slightly dated survey, but I don't think the results have moved since then. Of the 1,500 Indian companies that were surveyed, only 5% of directors on board are women. And of course, in contrast, 88% in S&P's 500 have at least one female member. So why do we talk about gender diversity? The fact is, and nobody can stress this enough anymore, that if we talk about companies like Infosys expanding their talent pool and hiring a civil engineer to do software code, and this is a point I was making to a few colleagues just before this presentation, is that you can do companies actually think that trying to make their workforce more gender diverse is a way of acquiring innovative talent? I mean, if they don't, then they better start doing that, because this is how the 21st century enterprise is going to look like. And why? And let me put that into context. Look at what's happening here. The reduction of supply of future executives in Europe and the US, and how it's dipping, it's going to make it only worse. So unless we tap onto resources that we haven't hitherto done, then we're already heading for trouble. And of course, data in India isn't as crisp, and therefore hasn't been factored into this slide. The Scott Page, of course, came up with this great idea called trackability, which is the average ability of members plus diversity of the group, and you would have a great mixture of success. So essentially what he's trying to say is that the more diversity you put into the group, more enriched your product's likely to be, because it wouldn't be selling Atta Dal Chawal on the street, as opposed to having a great amount of differentiation, and that is what diversity can do to your group. It can make your product stand apart. And he said, I don't need to do a lot of statistical analysis to prove this, but a simple theorem can prove me right. Now, when I tried to read this paper, I only could go to page 3 because it was so heavy on the mind, but this probability factor stuck in my head, and therefore I put it on the slide. So it's a simplistic way of representing it, but effective enough, I hope. Women are good bosses. Now at NDTV, actually my boss is a woman, and I'm not so sure about this. It makes sense, otherwise it's a battle that is already lost. If you'd like to go through this caricature, you know what I mean. Is it something I said in casual reference to something I did, when the thing I did shouldn't have been done, or at least done differently with more concern for your feelings? If you understood that, kudos to you. So what are the stages in an inclusivity program? How do you become inclusive? Now, everything starts with denial. We don't have a problem. We're very diverse. Everything is look, everybody's walking around, there's so many women, there's so many men. We haven't ever done statistical analysis in this company, but we're fine. When somebody tells you you're not, you become defensive, saying, oh, that is not on, right? Then you focus on similarities. Men are similar, women are similar, I'm similar, you're similar, everyone's similar. So why have a diversity initiative? And then there's a casual acceptance of differences. Say, well, yeah, we might be different, but we're okay, we're still okay. And then finally, when business or the ROI numbers go down, then you say, maybe we need to adapt to the new reality. And then the behaviors shift. Now, if I were in today's corporation, I would actually just crunch everything down to say, focus on similarities, yes, because that is important. But if you don't shift your behavior into making your workforce as diverse as possible, then the similarities will actually end. So that is the problem that we have. So what are the support systems that we need to create perhaps a more heterogeneous workforce? We need to have enablers, we need to have role models, again Dr. Warren spoke about that, and we need to have capability builders and culture that supports these things. So by creating an inclusive culture, it means you need to have your leaders as ambassadors. So if you're not leading by example, then you're just saying that it's just one of those initiatives and we don't really care. Consciously improve gender ratio. We've talked about reservations or positive discrimination or whatever. I think whatever you can do within the legal framework, you must, and see what works. There is no one size fits all, so it's a bit of trial and error. And I actually, I'm very fond of a trial and error because it allows you to consult your people and not just talk to them, it's talk with them is what I encourage. Have more women at senior levels. NDTV doesn't have that problem actually. Treating women as professionals, of course. And these are the enablers that are very true, and NDTV has experimented, thankfully, with all of them. We have flexi-working, sabbaticals, and these are, let me very forcefully say, these are not diversity initiatives. This is the hallmarks of an empathetic organization that we anyway should strive to become. Now, do I say NDTV is, wow, what a great place to work? By all means not. It does have its issues, but hopefully we're not eyeing over them, we're not glossing over them. So we have our issues, but what we're trying to do is to create an environment that is conducive to everyone and not just a group of people. Support agencies, transfers and alternate areas of work, it happens all the time, and teleworking is now very much in vogue. We're to build capability of people, and this is not true just one set of people, groups, women, men, and also people with disability, for instance. And in fact, all groups of people that work for NDTV, learning how to manage their time better, retraining returnees from sabbaticals, for instance, mentoring and coaching, be it external or internal, counseling and networking and assertiveness skills. Networking is very important. It is not enough to, as I is to just sit in a room and take decisions, but if you don't know the people well enough, the people you're working with, then perhaps you're not, you're doing a disservice to yourself. That applies actually to both men and women equally. Role modeling, need to have role models, people who've done it well, and therefore, to create a role model, we need to reward and recognize such people. We need to create career paths so that people can climb the ladder. They have something to look forward to, and therefore go on to become role models. So if you stifle people's creativity and their hunger and desire by not giving them a path that they can follow, then that is not a good role modeling practice. Governance at the highest levels, these issues cannot be dealt with by individual managers. They might be a frontline defense, but they're not generals, and therefore they might implement, but they can't be left to ideate all the time. And then, of course, leadership by example, which I mentioned earlier as well. If we just talk about typical gender diversity initiatives and their presence in the company's strategic agenda, look at optional flexible working, these are percentages. And you see that some of the initiatives, none of them have actually crossed 50%. So it just means that there is a lot of work that needs to be done, that still needs to be done, especially, for example, skill building programs, gender specific hiring goals. You're basically saying that you once you get people in, you try and do something, but you're not targeting talent acquisition, which should be goal number one, essentially. So, but there are some others like monitoring indicators of executive performance and options of flexible working, which are more in vogue because I suspect those are easier to implement. And there's a lot of literature that's now available and advice and consultancy that is available to help companies in doing that.